Our speaker today is Heejun Kim, who will speak to a small but select audience, and she will tell us something about stable subgroups and more subgroups of Heejun class groups.
Thanks for coming. Thanks for allowing me to speak in this seminar. Today, I'd like to talk about my recent work on stable subgroups and more subgroups of mapping class groups. So here is the outline. First, we briefly discuss quasi-convex subgroups in a world high-quality group, and then see some generalizations of hyperbolic geometry, and then discuss stable subgroups and more subgroups of finite degenerate group, and then discuss my recent work. So let's recall the definition of quasi-convex subgroup. So let G be a finitely generated group with a finite generic set S. Then a subgroup H is quasi-convex if there exists a constant N such that every geodesic in the Cayley graph with respect to the generic set S that connects a pair of points in H is contained in the N neighborhood of H. So by the definition, quasi-convexity depends on the choice of a generic set. In particular, when G is a world high-quality group, a quasi-convex subgroup is finitely generated and quasi-isometrically embedded in G, so that it is a hyperbolic space itself. And by hyperbolic geometry, quasi-convexity of a world hyperbolic group is independent on the choice of a generic set. Now, let's recall some properties of a quasi-convex subgroup in a world hyperbolic group. First, if we have two quasi-convex subgroups, then the intersection of H1 and H2 is quasi-convex in G. Second, the centralizer of any element G is a quasi-convex subgroup of G. And for an element of infinite order, the cyclic subgroup generated by G is quasi-convex in G. And an infinite quasi-convex subgroup has finite index in its commensal layer. Here, the commensal layer is the set of group elements with the intersection of H and GH. G inverse has finite index in H and GH, G inverse. So the commensal layer indeed contains the subgroup H, and it has finite index in the commensal layer. So to describe one more properties, let's recall the definitions of finite height and finite width. So let G be an arbitrary group and let H be a subgroup. Then we say that K conjugates are essentially distinct if the cosets are distinct. And we say a subgroup has finite height N if the intersection of every n plus 1 essentially distinct conjugates is finite, and here n is minimum possible. Finally, we say that H has finite width if n is the maximal cardinality of the set. Here, a collection ranges over all collections of distinct cosets. So for a collection, the intersection of any two cosets is infinite. So for example, a finite subgroup has finite height and finite width, and a subgroup of finite index has finite height and finite width. However, an infinite normal subgroup of infinite index doesn't have finite height and finite width. So a subgroup of infinite index has finite height, finite width, it means the subgroup is far from being a normal subgroup. And it turns out that a quasi-convex subgroup of a world hyperbolic group has finite height and finite width. Now discuss some generalizations of hyperbolic geometry. So now we have an arbitrary finitely generated group, and X be a proper geodesic metric space with a geometric action of G on X. Here, geodesic geometric action means the action is isometric, proper, and co-compact. Or we can think it as the calligraph of G with respect to a finite generic set S. So what we do is to focus on hyperbolic-like geodesics in X. Namely, we will look at Morse geodesics. So here is the definition. A geodesic gamma in a metric space X is called N Morse for a function N, which is from 1 to infinity times 0 to infinity to 0 to infinity. If for every kc and every kc quasi geodesic beta with n endpoints of gamma remains within distance nkc of gamma. Here nkc is the value of the function when the domain is k, c. This is a hyperbolic-like geodesic because when the group is a world hyperbolic group, there exists a function n such that any geodesic in the calligraph is n Morse. And here we call n is Morse gauge. So but from this perspective, Charney and Sulkhan defined the contracting boundary of a K0 space. So what they did is they're looking at Morse geodesics in a K0 space and then think about the limit points to define the contracting boundary. Then Morse geodesics for an ambient geodesic metric space has been studied in terms of divergence, contraction, middle recurrence, and so on. So in 2015, Holders defined the Morse boundaries for an finite generic group. Similarly, he focused on Morse geodesic rays and then think about the limit points. And we have two generalizations of quasi-convexity, namely stable subgroups and Morse subgroups. So I will focus on two notions in the rest of the talk. So first of all, stable subgroups. So here is the definition. So let G be a finitely generated group, and let H be a finitely generated subgroup. Then we say that H is stable if H is undistorted, and for any finite generic set S and K and C, there exists a constant L depending on S, K, C, such that for any pair of Kc quasi geodesics in G with the same endpoint on H, each quasi geodesic is contained in the L neighborhood of the other. So picture is we have two points, H1 and H2. These are elements in H. Then think about two Kc quasi geodesics. These are Kc quasi geodesics.
In the calligraph of G, right?
Yeah, in G. Then there exists some constant L. Its quasi geodesic is contained in the L neighborhood of the other. Then, by the definition, a stable subgroup is always quasi convex and hyperbolic. So, for quasi convexity, from the first condition, we have quasi-isometric embedding. So say we have K lambda quasi-isometric embedding. So to show this is quasi-convex, pick two points in H, in G, and then think about a geodesic in G, so say gamma. And now I will think about a geodesic between H1 and H2 in H. Then F beta is nothing but just lambda epsilon quasi geodesic. So we have f beta like this. But gamma is geodesic, so this is 1, 0 quasi geodesic. So this is also lambda epsilon quasi geodesic. So by the second condition, they're close. So stability implies quasi convexity, and stability also implies hyperbolicity because think about a geodesic triangle. Like H1, H2, H3, then think about the nearest point on this path to this point, say P. Then by some computation, we know this path is 3, 0 quasi geodesic. So this is 1, 0 quasi geodesic, so by the second condition, they're close. So indeed, the triangle is thin. And stability is preserved under quasi isometry as well. This is a generalization of quasi convexity because when G is a word hyperbolic group, H is stable if and only if H is quasi-convex. So this direction is obvious, and if H is quasi-convex, then by the hyperbolic geometry, we know this is stable indeed, because quasi-geodesic is close to a geodesic in a hyperbolic space. So now, think about stabilities in various settings. So for example, mapping class groups. So we have this theorem. So let S be a connected and oriented surface, which is neither the one punctured torus nor the four punctured sphere. Then subgroup H is convex co-compact if and only if H is stable in the mapping class group. So here, convex co-compact is a subgroup is convex co-compact if the orbit in the Taekwondo space is quasi-convex, or the orbit map of H is quasi-isometric embedding in the curve complex. So in those cases, we need other spaces to define convex co-compactness, like Taekwondo space or the curve complex. But this theorem tells us we can characterize convex co-compactness by looking at the geometry of mapping class group. And here we have two exceptions, the one punctured torus and the four punctured sphere, because their mapping class groups are virtually free, so every subgroups are quasi-convex, which means stable, but like there are some subgroups which generate by bent twist, which is not convex co-compact. So we should ignore two cases. And I introduced another characterization of convex co-compactness because I will use it later. So let the surface is unoriented, connected, finite type surface with negative Euler characteristic, then a subgroup H is convex co-compact if and only if H is finite, generate, undistorted, and purely spinoso. So for every element in H, the element is spinoso.
Every element of infinite order.
Yeah, infinite order. So now think of stabilities in the right-angled arching group. So the right-angled arching group on a graph has the following group presentation. So the generic set is the set of vertices, and if there is an edge between two vertices, then we have VU is equal to UV. So we have the following theorem. So suppose that gamma is connected and anti-connected, and a subgroup H is finitely generated, then the following are equivalent. First, H is stable. Second, some or any orbit map from H into the extension graph is a quasi-symmetric embedding. Here, extension graph is a hyperbolic space, and this is analog to the curve complex in the mapping classroom. And the right-angled Artin group acts on the extension graph acylindrically. So the last condition is H is purely lexodromic. It means for any infinite order element, the element acts the extension graph lexodromically. So now think about stabilities in general. So let G be a finite generated group, then a finitely generated subgroup H is stable if and only if H is bounded convex or compact. It means that the limit set of H in the worst boundary is compact, and H acts compactly on the recall of the limit set of H. Here, the limit set of H is the set of limit points of worst geodesics in H, and the recall of the limit set of H is the union of all geodesics connecting two distinct points in the limit set of H. So in the context of a world hyperbolic group, we have the following theorem. So a subgroup H of a world hyperbolic group is quasi-convex if and only if H acts co-compactly on the recall of the limit set of H in the Grundmann boundary of H. So the first theorem is a generalization of the second theorem. And it turns out that for a stable subgroup, the subgroup has finite height and finite width as well. Now think about worst subgroups. So here is the definition. Let G be a finitely generated group, and let H be a subgroup of G. Then a subgroup H is Morse or strongly quasi-convex subgroup if for a finite generic set S, and for K and C, there exists a constant M depending on S, K, C, such that every K, C quasi-geodesic in G with N points on H is contained in the M neighborhood of H. Here we have one quasi-geodesic, so this is stability. We need two quasi-convex quasi-geodesic, but for Morseness, so think about a KC quasi-geodesic, then this one is contained in the M neighborhood of H. Then a Morse subgroup is finitely generated and undistorted in G, and a Morse subgroup is quasi-convex in G because a geodesic is 1-0 quasi-geodesic. So by the definition, it follows that a Morse subgroup is quasi-convex in G. And Morseness is strong enough to be preserved under quasi-isometric. And a stable subgroup of G is Morse in G. So for this guy, we can use a similar argument here. So now I will think about so pick two points in H and to show it is Morse. So take any KC quasi-geodesic. In G. Then we have beta here. So like we have F beta here. by using this quasi-isometric embedding, then this is lambda epsilon quasi-geodesic. So take the maximum, then say k prime, both are k prime, c prime, quasi-geodesic. So k prime is the maximum of k and lambda. So they're both are k prime, c prime, quasi-geodesic. Then by the second condition of stability, they're close. So it implies the subgroup is Morse, right? So stability implies Morseness. And Morseness is another generalization of quasi-convexity, because when G is a word hyperbolic group, H is Morse if and only if H is quasi-convex. So for this, like, Morseness always implies quasi-convexity, and we saw that quasi-convexity is equivalent to stability in a word hyperbolic group. So three notions are equivalent in this setting. But two notions are different in general. For example, G cross Z is a non-stable Morse subgroup of itself, because there is no G cross Z is not hyperbolic. So this is not stable, because stability implies hyperbolicity. But this is whole group, so this is Morse subgroup. And trends show that in general, a subgroup is stable if and only if H is Morse and hyperbolic. Let's discuss some properties of Morse subgroups. So let G be a finitely generated group, and let A be an undistorted subgroup. Then if H is Morse subgroup, then the intersection of A and H is Morse in A. So in particular, if A is another Morse subgroup, then it implies that the intersection of H1 and H2 is Morse in H1 and H2, and a Morse group is undistorted, so the intersection indeed Morse in G as well. Also, he showed that for a Morse subgroup, H has finite height and finite width. So let's see how to use finiteness by using this lemma. So let G be a finitely generated group, and let H be a Morse subgroup. Then for an element G in G and H in H, if G and H commute, and the subgroup generated by H and G is isomorphic to Z to the 2, is undistorted in G, then there exists an f integer m such that G to the m is contained in H. So note that H has finite height and in G for some n, which means the n plus one intersection of conjugates is finite. So let's see how to use this fact. So suppose that G to the M is not in H for every M, then it implies for distinct IJ, G to the IH is not equal to G to the JH. So it means the N plus one conjugates are essentially distinct. Then since H and G commute, we have that the cyclic subgroup generated by H is contained in G to the I, H, G to the minus I, for I is from 1 to n plus 1, that it means the intersection n plus 1 intersection of the conjugates is infinite, because if this intersection contains this subgroup, then it contradicts that H has finite height A n in G, because it means this guy should be finite. So let's see worseness in various settings. So first of all, right angle directing group. So let gamma be a simply show finite connected anti-connected graph. Let H be a non-trivial infinite index subgroup of the right angled arctic group, then H is worse if and only if H is stable. So two notions are equivalent in this setting, the right angled arctic group. And what about right angled Cox's pair groups? So here, the right angled Cox's pair group of a graph, gamma, has the following group presentation. So the generic set is the set of vertices, and if there is an S between two vertices, then we have VU is equal to UV, and every generator has order 2. And trend shows that let if gamma be a simply shared triangle 3 graph and lambda be an induced subgraph, then the following conditions are equivalent. So first, the subgroup is Morse in the right angle Cox's pair group if and only if lambda contains two non-adjacent vertices of induced four cycle sigma, then gamma contains all vertices of sigma. So this theorem tells us stability is not equal to Morseness in this setting, because from the second condition, Morse subgroup can contain z cross z, but if a subgroup contains z cross z, then it is not hyperbolic, so that is not stable subgroup. So in this setting, two notions are different. And I think about two notions in the mapping class groups. So let S be a oriented, connected, finite type surface with negative Euler characteristic, which is neither the one-punctured torus nor the four-punctured sphere. Then let mod S be the mapping class group, and let G be a finitely generated subgroup. Then the followings are equivalent. So G is convex co-compact if and only if G is Morse of infinite index in the mapping class group. And this theorem implies that two notions are equivalent, stability and Morseness, because we know G is convex co-compact if and only if G is stable. So two notions are equivalent in this setting. Yeah, infinite index in the mapping class group. So this way is obvious. Stability implies Morseness. So we need to prove G is Morse of, if G is Morse of infinite index, then this is stable. So we need this direction. So suppose G is Morse of infinite index, but not stable. I will use one capitalization of stability, which is G is stable if and only if G is finitely generated, undistorted, and purely Stanosov. Since we start from the subgroup is Morse, so the subgroup is finitely generated and undistorted. So if the subgroup is not stable, then the subgroup is not purely Stanosov. So there exists a reducible element of infinite order such that H fixes a sum or simple closed curve alpha. So it means the cyclic subgroup generated by H is contained in the centralizer of that twist. Then the claim is that for any group element G, we have that the intersection of G inverse GG and the centralizer of Dent twist is finite. So if I show this claim, then in particular when G is 1, it means the intersection of G and the centralizer is finite. But this is a contradiction because in the centralizer I have H and I pick H in G, so this is not finite set. So if I show this claim, then the proof is complete. So let's show the claim. Now I will get one more contradiction. So suppose the intersection is infinite for some z0. Then I need two facts. So the first fact is actually the intersection has finite index in the centralizer of the twist. And the second fact is for any group element in the mapping class group, the intersection has finite index in the centralizer. So for the first fact, I use that the intersection of G0 inverse G0 and the centralizer of the twist is indeed a Morse subgroup in the centralizer of the twist, and then used finite Heitnis. And for the second one, to connect G0 to Z, I use the curve complex. So note that because it is a Morse subgroup, G has finite height in the mapping class group for some n. And we start from the index. G has infinite index in the mapping class group, so we have n plus 1 distinct elements such that the cosets are distinct. Now I use the second one for every GI's, so then I get the intersection of them has finite index in the centralizer because each of them has finite index. Then it implies n plus 1 intersection should be infinite, but it contradicts that G has finite height in finite n in the mapping class group because G has finite height, so this one should be finite. So basically I used two contradictions for the proof. So now I have some questions. So first, can we capitalize an arbitrary Morse or stable subgroup in the right-angled Cox-Tay group? Because Tran just did special subgroups, which induced by a subgraph. But what about general subgroup in the right-angled Cox-Tay group? And second, when is a Morse subgroup of infinite index in a hierarchically hyperbolic group stable? Here, a hierarchically hyperbolic group was introduced by Perenstock, Hagen, and Sito in 2014, and this group is motivated by the mapping class groups and right-angled Artin groups. So I'm interested in to characterize Morse subgroups and stable subgroups in this setting as well. So thank you for attention.
Very good. Any questions?
No question.
Yeah.
The last question that you asked, is that something that you're actively working on right now?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
You can discuss it if you have any ideas. Can you show that question? Because this is about HHS spaces, right? Yeah, but there is, seems to be something difficult there. I mean, it's an interesting question, but it's not. It doesn't seem to be like. At first, we thought that there may be some low hanging fruit, but it doesn't seem to be so low hanging, you know. So, but I mean, you should probably talk, you know, because you know something like that. What is it so far? Yeah, it seems harder than. So, I mean, she didn't show us the proof of these two claims, in particular of claim two. I mean, in the class group case, you know, in her proof, there was a curve complex argument, you know, yeah, which is special to the Mecham class group case, and it doesn't work in the HHS group. One of the tests that we checked. You know, so. And even if one assumes that one is in the context where the Bromberg Weininger between a serum is available, you know, about characterizing commercial compactness. I mean, like, you know, so stability in terms of being purely oxytonic, right? You know. Which is sort of known, at least for some class of these things now. That's still not enough, you know, so, but it does have sense. So, yeah. So this is what we've